Hey you guys, it's Peter and welcome to my channel, Peterisms, where I tell stories of my life and just little things I've learned as I've grown into the person that I am today. And we're gonna talk about the holidays today. It was interesting because I saw this meditation and it was actually one that I chose not to read and I saved it for the video today because I think it's a good topic for conversation. And you know, holidays are interesting for me because you know, I've talked a lot about this on my vlog this year and what holidays were like when I was growing up, the magical parts of it, the misery part of it, on and on and on. And, you know, growing up in the home of an alcoholic, you never really know what to expect from holidays and you hope for this, you know, magic. And I think that one of the reasons why I have so fallen in love with Christmas movies and Christmas books and things like that is because that's how I kind of always wanted to imagine Christmas, you know, that Santa Claus would come and save the day, things like that, or, you know, that we would go and escape to the North Pole and save Christmas, or go to the Smoky Mountains like Dolly Parton. I was actually watching that last night. My favorite Christmas movie of life is Smoky Mountain Christmas with Dolly Parton. The entire movie is on YouTube, and in fact, if I remember, I'll link it below because I know some people have heard me talk about it, and somebody even mentioned the other day that they went and watched it, and it's just a very sweet family movie. But you know, like, I think that for me, I always had this idea that I wanted the holidays to be perfect, and you know, many alcoholics and addicts strive for perfection either, or even. For me, I think that I also, you know, like, it was either always that I was between perfection and failure. There was like no in between for me. Like I was either completely unsuccessful at something or I was extremely successful. And that's kind of how I viewed things. Like, yes, I was really good at this, or no, this was a complete disaster. And so, you know, in life, that's been a real struggle for me because the things that I haven't been great at, like for example, losing weight in the past, I get very, very discouraged very quickly, right? So when Christmas or Thanksgiving or whatever holiday would come around and it wasn't necessarily going the way that I wanted it to go. This is even as a child, because of, you know, my mom drinking too much or other family members drinking too much or whatever, it would start bothering me. And then like my whole attitude about Christmas would kind of go down. It's interesting, you know, when you start losing people that you've spent every holiday with in your entire life, like, you know, in the last 11 years, I've lost my mom, I've lost my aunt, I've lost my uncle. What Christmas looked like back in the day growing up for, you know, I don't know, 35, you know, 5 years of my life, 36 years when my mom passed away, and then with my aunt, because she really kind of continued those same traditions. It doesn't look the same anymore. You know, now Christmas, I spend Christmas Eve with my husband's family and it goes late and it's very fun and it's festive and it's different. You know, the Christmas Eves that I had growing up were quiet dinners and then there would be kind of like a cocktail party afterwards, but it's just very different, you know? And I was talking to a friend of mine yesterday, actually, whose father passed away recently. And I was saying to her, like, are you doing okay through the holidays? And she said, I'm just ready for it to be over, honestly. And I said, well, how's your mom doing? And she said, you know, she's in like this grief group and she's doing really well. And she said, one of the things that they recommended to her was that, you know, you change all your traditions the first year. You don't do things the same way that you did them every other year because it'll make you relive the same traditions without that person. And so it almost like, it impacts it worse. It makes it worse for you. And I said to her, I said, oh my God, I never thought of it that way. That's great, you know? Well, what's interesting about that is that I've also spoken about how the holidays haven't really bothered me since my mom has been gone, you know? But what's interesting about that is that my mother passed away in, you know, the spring of 2008. Alex and I got together in August, and my first Christmas with him was that Christmas Eve that I went to his family's house. So my traditions completely changed that year around the holidays, and I had never connected it until she said that yesterday. So, you know, if you're going through some grief right now or whatever, maybe try some new traditions, try something new. I think it's a great suggestion. But I think the holidays are hard for all of us, and I think really a lot of it is about going into holidays with having certain kinds of expectations, you know, whether it's on a superficial level of a gift that you want to receive, or it's going to be romantic, or, you know, we're going to get proposed to, or whatever, you know, it is. People are always like, do you think you should propose on Christmas? I'm like, well, if it doesn't work out, like, that's the worst Christmas forever, you know? But anyway, but I think there's like all of these, you know, things that go into what expectations are going to be like, you know? And it's funny because my cousin Caroline and I, we laugh because There's a movie with Holly Hunter called Home for the Holidays, and it literally was our family. I mean, it really, really was. Right down to the crazy aunt who was my mom and all this kind of stuff, you know? And it very much was like that. And if you've ever seen the movie, why can't I think of the actor's name? But anyway, oh God, he's in all those Marvel movies now. But Caroline was like Holly Hunter, and I was the brother, and I can't think of what his name is now. But anyway, Robert Downey Jr., that was who the character that I was in the movie. If you've seen the movie, you'll know why. So anyway, but you know, like, I think, like, once you accept that your family's kind of probably a little crazy, you're going to be okay getting through the holidays, you know? And then it's, like, embrace the fun. Embrace the time that you actually get to spend with people and be with them. And, you know, I'm like, a sideline person. Like, it's very, very difficult for me to just, like, jump in and be part of things. And, you know, even with Alex's family, like, I have been part of the family now for almost 11 years. And, you know, I still, like, I struggle, like, because I just am, I'm so socially awkward. I know it's hard to believe when you see me on camera, but I really am, and I have a lot of social anxiety, and so it's really hard for me to, like, force myself into, like, you know, that I'm better at observing and sitting on the sidelines. It's actually, I wrote that into my book that I wrote about the main character. People actually always ask me about the main character. They're like, are you more like him or more like this other kid in the book? And I was like, no, I was definitely more like Danny. I'm like a Danny. I'm very quiet, like, in, you know, I have social anxiety, you know, through the roof. So holidays are hard for me too, because I have to kind of go in, and sometimes I have to put on a mask and be like, hey, how are you? And all that kind of stuff. And I'm better at that today. And, you know, I'm more relaxed in those situations. So I try to go into holidays with no expectations. I try to just go into it and be like, I'm going to have a great holiday. It's going to be fun, you know, whatever. So anyway, yeah, so I think that would be, you know, two great suggestions. Number one, that my friend told me, you know, maybe start some new traditions, not just relive the same traditions. Whether that's you're going through, you know, you've lost somebody, you know, that they've passed on, or you're going through a divorce or a breakup, maybe change some traditions. I think that's a great suggestion, and it's something that I'm going to take a look at. And the other great suggestion is, no, I mean, this is just a life lesson. Don't go into anything with really high expectations, because then you won't be let down. You know, if you go into it with realistic expectations, you'll probably be magically surprised, and it'll be even better than you thought it would be. At least that's what I've learned in my life, you know. So today's meditation is from Melody Beatty's The Language of Letting Go. How did you ever guess? Oh my God, if you guessed that, you got extra credit. Okay, and today's is called Holiday Triggers, December 23rd. 1 year when I was a child, my father got drunk and violent at Christmas. I had just unwrapped a present, a bottle of hand lotion, when he exploded in an alcoholic rage. Our Christmas was disrupted. It was terrible. It was frightening for the whole family. Now, 35 years later, whenever I smell hand lotion, I immediately feel all the feelings I did that Christmas. The fear, the disappointment, the heartache, the helplessness, and an instinctive desire to control. Anonymous. I think that's so interesting, isn't it? How we connect even, like, the smallest details to things. I still, honest to God, do that to this day. It's like, I think I shared this story on my vlog, but one of my last Christmases, or no, it would have been like Thanksgiving or Easter, because we used to go to Gatlinburg for Christmas. My mother always made deviled eggs, and she had this deviled egg tray that I actually still have in there. If anybody wants one, it's green. It's not very pretty. But anyway, and we were like walking in, and it must have been Thanksgiving because it was kind of icy outside, and she slipped, and she didn't fall, but she slipped, and like all of the eggs like flew out onto the ground, and she was like panicked, right? And like whenever I see deviled eggs, I still remember that, because like she came inside and my aunt was just kind of like, it's no big deal, don't worry about it. My mom was like, it is a big deal, this is the only thing, you know, blah, blah, blah. This and the rolls are the only things I ever contribute. And she was so upset about it, and to this day when I see deviled eggs, I still think of that, you know? So I do think it's interesting, like, those attachments that we have to those kinds of things. There are so many positive triggers that remind us of Christmas. Snow, decorations, silent night, jingle bells, wrapped packages, a nativity scene, stockings hung on a fireplace. These triggers can evoke in us the warm, nostalgic feelings of the Christmas celebration. There are other kinds of triggers, though, that may be less apparent and evoke different feelings and memories. Our mind is like a powerful computer. It links sight, sound, smell, touch, and taste with feelings, thoughts, and memories. It links our senses, and we remember. Sometimes the smallest, most innocuous incident can trigger memories. Not all our memories are pleasant, especially if we grew up in an alcoholic, dysfunctional setting. We may not understand why we feel afraid, depressed, or anxious. We may not understand what has triggered our codependent coping behaviors, the low self-worth, the need to control, the need to neglect ourselves. When that happens, we need to understand that some innocuous event may be triggering memories recorded deep within us. If something, even something we don't understand, triggers painful memories, we can pull ourselves back into the present by self-care, acknowledging our feelings, detaching, working the steps, and affirming ourselves. We can take action to feel good. We can help ourselves feel better each Christmas. No matter what the past held, we can put it in perspective and create a more pleasant holiday today. Today, I will gently work through my memories of this holiday season. I will accept my feelings, even if I consider them different from what others are feeling this holiday. God, help me let go, heal from, and release the painful memories surrounding the holidays. Help me finish my business from the past so I can create the holiday of my choice. I think that's a really, really good meditation. And I think, like, you know, one of the things I heard in there was sit in your feeling, don't push it away. But I also think at the same time, you know, like for me, it's important to not just remember the ugly. I mean, it's really easy for me to remember the ugly alcoholic parts of growing up with a mother that was an alcoholic at Christmas. You know, I told a story on my vlog recently about my mom putting the car in the ditch on Christmas Eve. And, you know, it forever changed what Christmas Eve and Christmas Day was like, because before that it was like always at my aunt's house. And then after that it changed because they didn't let my mom drive me on Christmas Eve anymore. I have that memory. I have a memory of like the first year that my parents were divorced or first year separated, and my dad was trying to be part of that Christmas, and my mom got very intoxicated and almost physically fought my dad for him just being there and representing the misery in her life. Those are not the memories that I want to remember. I don't want to remember my mom weaving down the hallway, okay? And that's how I found out there was no Santa Claus, because I could see her from my bedroom putting the Christmas presents downstairs as she was weaving drunk down the hallway the year that she put the car in the ditch. I don't want to think about her screaming and yelling, you know, obscenities at my dad as, you know, like everybody's rushing out of the house. I don't want to remember that. I don't want to remember being worried about my mom on Christmases that I stayed with my dad because she was too intoxicated. I want to remember the good times. And you know, there were so many good times. And in fact, I was allowed to have 13 years of 13 fantastic Christmases with my mother, or just short of 13 fantastic Christmases with my mother. And you know, I look at that and I feel very, very blessed. And it was a special time for us. My mom moved at Christmas time and the same time that I was in treatment. And it's kind of a rebirth to some degree, Christmas time is for me. And so I look at this as a very, very spiritual time. One of my favorite memories with my mother was as I got older and we were both sober, she used to do this when I was a child too, and I can remember being in my bed and I could hear it late at night. But as I got older, we would go over to my aunt's house for Christmas Eve, and then we would have dinner and all that. The cocktail party would still continue, but at about 10 or 11, my mom and I would leave. We would check out of the cocktail party and we would come back here to the condo, and we would sit around and she would make coffee and we would sit around and talk and you know, tell stories. Sometimes we walked. It was like a big tradition of ours to walk on Christmas Eve. We did that a lot outside and felt very spiritual and just talked about kind of the year and things. But then she would always watch the midnight mass at, what is it, St. Paul's Cathedral, St. Peter's Cathedral, anyway, you know, the Vatican with the Pope. And she always watched that, and she loved to just sit there and listen, because it was so silent and she could hear the service. And if you've never watched it, you have to watch it just once, okay? Just even 20 minutes of it. And even if you're not Catholic, because we weren't Catholic, it's just something about the silence and the solitude of where it all began. And I always remember my mom like listening to that as I was a kid growing up. And that for me is a very positive memory. I also remember taking those walks with her, drinking coffee with her, sitting around, talking, reminiscing about past Christmases, the ones that were good, sitting here talking about the Christmas Eve that we had just had and kind of laughing about some funny things that had happened in the evening, and then finishing the night up watching, you know, the late night mass at the Vatican. And I'll never forget that. You know, those were like very, very silent moments for me, which is probably why my favorite Christmas hymn of life is Silent Night. And my favorite version of it, I know this is hilarious, is John Denver and the Muppets version of Silent Night. And if you've never heard of it or heard it, half of it is German and half of it is English. And it's fantastic, and it explains at the beginning how the song came about to begin with, and I love that version. If I can find a version of it, I will link it below with a Smoky Mountain Christmas. So I don't know, maybe it's good for us to, you know, we talk about doing inventory, to make an inventory of all of the good Christmas memories we have. I think it's always easy, especially when we have like, you know, some anxiety of going into a situation and we have our expectations high, we start thinking about all of the bad Christmas memories, the negative Christmas memories. But maybe this year to focus on the positive Christmas memories, you know? Tell some funny stories about the people that have passed. Joke a little bit, laugh. Remember them with fondness, and try to have the best Christmas you can possibly have. I love you guys, and I hope you have a fantastic Christmas, and I will see you later. Bye.